I've always found that if you want to learn something, knowing why you want to learn it is going to be what you need to actually follow through. Otherwise, if it's just some bozo on YouTube saying, learn DSA or you'll never be a true programmer, then I'd probably just go play League of Legends or something. While learning DSA is good to know if you want to get a job at a FAANG company, the real reason is far more important. That reason is that it will change how you think and try and solve a coding problem. Simply put, data structures are how you organize data in your program so that it's easily accessible. Algorithms are a specific set of instructions aimed to solve a problem. Solving a problem with code is great, but sometimes the way you do it can be terrible, even if it seems to work. Understanding that your code is bad can be the difference between a good programmer and a clueless programmer. But how do you know if your code is good or bad? We use something called big O notation. Let's look at a simple example. Let's say we want to get the total sum of all values from a list. Each time we get each element from the list can be considered a single operation. So we'll have 5 total operations if we find the total length of our list is 5, but 10 if the length of the list is 10. We can see that the time our function takes to complete is dependent on the input and what the code is doing with the input. That is called time complexity, or as I said before, we call it big O. This code has a time complexity of order n. This is because the amount of time it takes to complete is linear, where n is the size of the input to the function. Common complexities include order 1, or constant time, order n, like our sum function, order n squared, order log n, order n log n, order 2 to the n, and order n factorial. Let's say if instead we wanted to add the first value from our list to another number and return it. This function is obviously different from the previous function, but it also doesn't matter how large the list is. If its length is 1 or 100,000, it doesn't really matter because it's still doing a single operation. In this case, because the size of the inputs to the function don't really matter, its big O is order 1 or constant. This is the fastest a function could be. Remember, this all ultimately comes down to the number of operations or the work required for your code. The big O is always looking for the worst case scenario because you can't just code for the best case scenario. To illustrate why the difference between each function is so drastic, let's look at the difference between each of the common complexities with the same size of input. As we can see here, order 1 or constant, order log n, order n, even order n log n, are pretty okay with a size of 10. But once you get down to order 2 to the n, order n squared, or order n factorial, these numbers become pretty big. Another thing to be mindful of is space complexity. This can be thought of as similar to time complexity, except it's the relationship between inputs and the amount of space that's needed, or memory. So, what's an example of order log n? Say you want to find something in a list, and that list is in order, which is usually a requirement in order to make something fast. What a human would do is look at some place in the middle of the list. Then, if we've passed what we're looking for, go to the middle of the first half, otherwise the middle of the second half, and then keep doing that until you find what you're looking for. This is called binary search, and it works just like you're reading a dictionary. Maybe not reading, looking through a dictionary. Who reads dictionaries? Lists are a form of data structure that you're probably familiar with. A list technically has a default size, but when you try to add a value to a list that's full, it will actually double the size of the list and then copy values to the new list and update the pointer. While this can take some time, it's generally considered constant time, or order 1, because it doesn't happen often. As we saw before, finding elements in a list can be fast, but that also requires that the list is sorted. So, how do you sort a list? The simplest algorithm to sort a list is called bubble sort, but it's also the least efficient at order n squared. So let's look at merge sort, which is far better. For merge sort, we split the list into pairs and find which value between the two is larger or smaller. Then we merge them back together. As we merge them back together, the result is a sorted list. This algorithm has a time complexity of order n log n. That's because we split the list into two pairs and compare those pairs. This is order log n. But then we have to compare each value when we merge the pairs, which is then order n, since it will eventually need to compare every element. Therefore, we get order n log n. This is actually the fastest we can sort a list. It doesn't get any faster than that. A linked list will have a node that maintains a pointer to the next element. This means it's really easy to increase the size of the list and insert or drop elements because we are just changing the pointer. But it is generally not that efficient because if you need to search for a value in the list, it takes order n time, since you have to always start at the beginning. A linked list can also maintain a pointer to the previous node. This is known as a doubly linked list. Another type of data structure that has nodes are trees. Not those trees, these trees. A binary tree is a data structure which has a root node and then has 0 to 2 children, which are the left and right nodes. If a node doesn't have any child nodes, then it's considered a leaf node. You get all the tree stuff. A binary search tree is a sorted tree where for each node, the left child's value is less than the current node, and the right child's value is greater than or equal to the current node. This allows you to find elements, delete elements, and insert elements extremely quickly. In fact, it's order H, where H is the height of the tree, which is great because the height for a balanced tree will be log n. A balanced tree is just a tree where each sibling node has the same number of children. If you just insert an already sorted list into a tree, you might just make a tree where the height is n, or basically a linked list. This can be solved by using a different type of tree, such as a red-black tree, which stores extra metadata within it that allows it to keep itself sorted. You probably won't encounter binary search trees in your day-to-day coding, but people love asking about them during interviews. A try, no, it's not spelled incorrectly, is a form of tree that stores string characters at each node. A try is a fantastic data structure if you need to store many words, as you can use a try to reuse characters. Say your try has cat and you want to enter can. Well, you just need to add a new node. Then, if you want to add candle, then you can reuse can. Just add DLE. Each node will typically contain some additional metadata about the contents of the node, like if it's a valid word or etc. A graph is like a tree fell over, but there can be any number of connections from one node to another. So all trees are graphs, but not all graphs are trees. A graph's node is often called a vertex, and a graph will contain a list of these vertices and also edges, which link the vertices together. A graph can be directed, meaning sub can only go to scribe, if you know what I mean. Or undirected, where you can go anywhere. Scribe sub. Graphs are an extremely powerful data structure, as they can be used for many problems you might encounter in your day-to-day. Let's imagine you want to go from your house to the nearest McDonald's. You can use a graph to figure out the best way to do this. You can then use breadth-first search to determine which is the shortest distance from your house to McDonald's. The first time we reach the McDonald's node on your graph from our home node is then the shortest path. But in the real world, if you were to do this on Google Maps, you would see that there are sometimes better ways to go from A to B, even if it's not technically the shortest. That's because an edge can also have a weight. A weight is the cost that it takes to go from one vertex to another vertex. A famous way to do breadth-first search and care about weights is called Dijkstra's algorithm. Feel free to look in the description for that one, though, because it could be a video all by itself. A hash map is basically a dictionary in Python. it's a key value data structure that is built on top of arrays. The reason it's so powerful is because you can insert, delete, and retrieve values in order one or constant time. How does it actually do this though? Like, a string is not a value in an array. It uses something called a hash function. When you pass it the key of Jake, it will run through a hash function and return a hash code. The hash code is then modded against the length of the underlying list, and we use that as the index for the list of values. This means that the hash function needs to consistently return the same hash code. Otherwise, we lose the pointer, and we wouldn't know that Jake is cool. And we've got to remember that. It's also possible that a hash function could have two different keys resulting in the same index. So maybe Sammy also results in 156. This is called a collision, and it can happen when you create a hash function. When this is done, the value list might contain a linked list, so you can find the correct value within that linked list. That's it. Now you know all the major data structures and why some of them are better than others. If you want me to go over any of these data structures or algorithms more in depth in the future, let me know in a comment down below. I've also added free online courses to the description if you want to really dig into this stuff. Now, what should we do with this newfound knowledge? Make your code hella better? Or just do some practice problems to get better at coding? If you want to do that, check out LeetCode. I'm sure you've heard of it. It's got a huge list of programming problems and solutions where you can learn from. There's also a list in the description of 75 problems that can be super helpful for interviews. If you're planning on practicing for interviews though, I would personally vouch for InterviewCake. It's a paid service that I actually used to prep for my Google interviews, and I've been there for 6.5 years now, so it worked. And this is not an ad. I'm not getting paid at all for this, but I did reach out to them and they did offer a 10% discount for any people who watch my channel. So the link is in the description. If you don't want to do either of those things, or just the free stuff, or not even that, I don't care. Do whatever you want. Again, not getting paid for this. I just figured if I can get you guys a deal, might as well try. Anyways, I hope you liked this video. Consider subscribing for more like this in the future. And remember, I'm Jake. You're awesome. This has been Data Structures and Algorithms. Cheers.